This is the day that the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. Hello and welcome to the Worship of God with the First Presbyterian Church in South St. Paul, Minnesota. It has been an interesting week, to say the least. A lot of waiting and anxiety about the outcome of the presidential election, and whichever candidate wins or loses, how their constituents will respond. And that I mean with violence and civil unrest in the streets or not. It goes without saying that 2020 has been a difficult and challenging year. And as we also watch the number of positive cases, hospitalizations, and deaths from COVID-19 skyrocket, it doesn't seem to be settling down anytime soon. And so we are glad and we are grateful that you have chosen to worship with us this day, to turn to the source of life and love and find some comfort, some hope, and some peace for our weary souls. As I record this welcome, it is still Thursday, November 5th, and so who knows what might have possibly occurred in the meantime. But what I do know, and what hasn't changed, and what won't change, is that God is with us. There is nothing, not even elections and pandemics, that can separate us from the love that is God. Grace abounds, and the only one who can truly provide peace in the midst of our fears and anxieties, God, wasn't on the ballot. Now, during the worship service, there will be a minute for mission, reminding you to help with the Adopt-A-Family Christmas program through Neighbors, Inc. But I also want to remind you that we are still receiving donations through November 22nd, to help support the Union Gospel Mission Thanksgiving dinners. $25 buys a full turkey dinner for a family in need. You can send donations to the church address or electronically through our website. Both of these addresses will be displayed later in the worship service. Also, don't forget to get your order for your Christmas wreaths and/or swags into the church office by next Sunday, November 15th. They will be ready for pickup on Sunday, November 29th, with more detailed information to follow. The money raised goes to help support our youth for what we hope will be a summer mission trip in 2021. And finally, what are you thankful for? During the pastoral prayer in our Sunday worship service on November 22nd, just before the Thanksgiving holiday, we would like to include your own giving of thanks. So we are asking that you and or your family either take a short video, 30 seconds or less, or send a picture stating what you are thankful for. Get creative, have fun, and send your photos and videos to Alita in the church office no later than November 17th. And of course, it goes without saying, an emphatic reminder that the building may be closed, but the church remains open. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. every week as we worship together, we have the opportunity to admit to ourselves, to each other, and to God, that we do not always live as we are called. In this time of prayer, this time of opening our hearts, let us remember that God is merciful and just, eager to offer grace and love. Let us pray. God of Israel and God of Jesus, we would not be here if you had not chosen to touch our lives with your love. Yet we confess that we sometimes have trouble in our decision-making when faced with questions of whether we wholeheartedly serve you or not. Forgive us when the choices we make reflect not your generosity, but our own selfishness. Forgive us when the choices we make revolve around judging or condemning others without first listening to their stories. Forgive us when the choices we make contribute to our own prosperity and well-being while ignoring the needs of others. Gracious and loving God, strengthen us where we are weak with the renewing power of your Spirit, so that the choices we make clearly reveal our identity as your faithful people and as sincere and devoted followers of Jesus, your Son, our brother. Amen. And now let us come before God in silence, offering our own particular needs for divine forgiveness. Receive now the assurance of God's grace. Encourage one another with these words. We will be with God forever. Do not grieve as those who have no hope. Enter into God's mercy and love.
Oh, good morning. Sorry about that. You caught me by surprise. I was just playing some video games this morning. Let me go ahead and shut this down. And there we go. I bet you guys are here for children's time, aren't you? I knew it. I have a note from Pastor Tom about what children's time is about today. So I'll go ahead and read that. So this morning, we're talking about Joshua. Now Joshua, he's about to lead the Israelites into the promised land. And they've been waiting for this for 40 years, a really, really long time. And he's worried that things are going to be so good and there's going to be like so many great things in there that the Israelites, the people, are going to forget about God and all the things that God has done for them in, you know, the past 40 years, especially since, you know, their exodus from Egypt and getting out of that situation. And he's really worried that there's going to be so many things that are going to grab their attention that they're going to forget. Sometimes we forget. You know, sometimes you have weeks where the only time you think much about God is on Sundays. That happens. It happens to me too sometimes. We're not perfect. There's so many things now that grab our attention. We have phones. We have video games, we have YouTube, and there's so many things around us that can grab our attention so easily. We have access to pretty much infinite entertainment and things to distract us from what's going on sometimes. And I usually turn to video games. Pretty much if I'm not working or shopping or, you know, getting out of the house somehow, I am playing video games. Animal Crossing is a new game that came out in March. I've played it for 580 hours so far, which is not insignificant. 580 hours I've put into Animal Crossing alone since March. So, and actually, I love gaming so much, I have more than one Nintendo Switch. It grabs my attention. And sometimes I do. I forget. Because I'm human and I'm not perfect. These things grab my attention. And sometimes I do forget to sit down and take some time and acknowledge the ways that God is working in my life. And God is always working in our lives. And some weeks we forget to acknowledge that. I know this week, though, I've been praying a lot. I've been reflecting a lot. But most weeks, I'm going to be honest, sometimes it's really hard. There's lots of other things around to see and do and engage with. And unfortunately, it can be easy to forget sometimes. So let's all make a better effort to think about all the ways that God has impacted our lives in our everyday, not just on Sundays, okay? And like Joshua said, as for me and my family, I will serve the Lord. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for everything you do, for all of the ways in which you bless us, and for all the gifts that you have given us, and for always being there, both in our good times and in our bad times. And all God's children said, Amen.
Thank you. Please join me now in the prayer for illumination. O God of infinite love and unending challenge, help us to listen to your call. Inspire us to reflect your love and embody your spirit of hospitality. Find our hearts open to your transforming power, and find us a sign of your unconditional welcome to all people who seek you. Amen. A reading from the book of Joshua. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your ancestors, Terah and his sons Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Then I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him through all the land of Canaan and made his offspring many. Now therefore revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. Now if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you are living. But as far as me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who did these great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we will also serve the Lord, for he is our God." But Joshua said to the people, "You cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm, consume you after having done you good." And the people said to Joshua, "No, we will serve the Lord." Then Joshua said to the people, "You are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." He said, "Then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel." The people said to Joshua, "The Lord our God we will serve, and him we will obey." So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and made statutes and ordinances for them at Shechem. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I have been extremely fortunate over my 24 years as a pastor to have had a number of mentors who helped me navigate the sometimes stormy and tempestuous waters of ordained ministry. It is a relatively small number, but even one is still a number. Most likely at the top of that very exclusive list would be a former pastor of this very congregation, who many of you also had the privilege of knowing, the Reverend Paul Truen. On many occasions when I thought the road ahead was impossible or that I was a failure, he would calm me down with exactly the right words of wisdom that I needed to hear at the time. I miss him, his friendship and his counsel, and a whole lot right now. On one occasion, we were discussing the task of preaching, and he wanted to know just how many hours I spent in study, reading biblical commentaries and other secondary texts related to the week's lectionary passage, as well as time meditating on the text in preparation for writing the sermon, and how many hours I spent actually composing the sermon. As Paul himself was fond of telling me, he was a pastor during a time in the history of our nation when all you had to do was put a cross on top of a building and the next Sunday the pews would be full. Paul never referred to having an office when he was the pastor. He had a study, his study, the pastor's study. I envy him and that period in the church's history. Anyway, in response to his question, I told him that I really didn't have time to actually study the week's scripture reading, maybe an hour quickly glancing at some articles on the internet, and that my sermons were typically written on Fridays, my scheduled day off, or late Saturday nights, maybe a few more hours, hopefully only a few more hours. But I wouldn't be telling the full truth if I didn't acknowledge finishing the Sunday sermon on occasion while sitting in my office on Sunday morning, minutes before the worship service was about to begin. Of course, now the sermon has to be finished by Wednesday night so that it can be recorded after the Thursday morning men's study group, and to the editors, Jason Johnson and Gene Dempko, by the end of the day on Thursday. Recording all the pieces for the Sunday worship service takes another 3 or 4 hours. I think I know or knew Paul well enough, especially near the end of his life here on earth, to say that he would have probably quit under these circumstances. Of course, he had his publishing company to fall back on. All this is to say that Paul came from a time 40, 50 years ago when the sermon was more important to the worship service, and parish pastors had a lot more time and were given greater allowances by the congregation to prepare and write the Sunday sermon. In the Reformed tradition, you may have noticed, the reading of Scripture, once illuminated by the Holy Spirit in prayer, and the interpretation of the reading in the sermon, is the centerpiece in the liturgical order of our worship of God. The call to worship, the prayer for forgiveness and assurance of God's grace, are to prepare us, to prepare our hearts and minds to hear God's word. And the pastoral prayer and the offering, as well as the sacrament of communion, are our response to the hearing of God's word. I could say that the preaching of the sermon used to be considered more important to the gathered community of faith in past decades, but I don't know that for certain, and it would only be an assumption on my part. What I do know, or at least what I perceive, is that it seems to have lost its significance to us. It is something that we time with our watches in the hopes that it doesn't go too long. It is something that we don't want the pastor spending too much time preparing for and writing in their study because there are so many more important things for them to be doing. It is something that we hope is entertaining, that has a funny story, anecdote, or a relatable movie reference. Though much of that, the perceived need to be entertaining, falls directly on the shoulders, or more accurately, the ego of the preacher, in this case, me. There are so many other things more enjoyable we could be doing than listening to some yahoo, me, try to interpret and preach God's word to us. At us. Watch Hallmark Christmas movies, get some chores done, sleep an extra hour, and then read the newspaper with a hot cup of dark roast coffee. How many of us come to the sermon in the hopes that our already tightly held social and political views will be affirmed? And or, how many of us come to the sermon to listen for potential attacks against our tightly held social and political views? Are we more apt to listen to the words of our favorite politicians and candidates than we are the Word of God? Is that because we believe politics has greater influence in shaping our personal and collective identity, as well as how we live with one another, than our faith does? How many of us truly come to the scripture reading and sermon to have our lives and our worldviews challenged, to be surprised, to be changed, to be transformed by the Word of God? I really do wonder. Plenty of us are probably nodding our heads right now and thinking to themselves, yes, how many of you other people actually do listen to the sermon so that you can be changed to be just like me, enlightened just like me, self-actualized just like me? Sidebar, None of us, including the preacher, have reached a point along our journeys of faith where we no longer need to change, need to grow in our faith, our relationship with God and our sisters and brothers. None of us. How many times has someone met me at the back door of the sanctuary and told me that they hoped people, implying other people, were listening today? And so I'm left to wonder, is the reason why the sermon seems to have lost its importance and significance in the life of the congregation because we don't want to be changed, to be made aware of just how imperfect and flawed is our following of Jesus, to be told that we may not always be right, that there may actually be times when we are just flat out wrong? And does the preacher, knowing that the congregation doesn't want to be challenged, doesn't want to be told that their political views may not be entirely biblical, that they may be wrong, and those other people, you know, those people, them, may be right, or at least not as wrong as we want to believe they are, does the preacher instead choose to find ways to not offend people, not preach God's word for fear that someone's political views might feel attacked, to water down the gospel and thus diminish, on their own, the transforming power of the sermon that they have been called to preach? So what does any of this have to do with today's passage from the book of Joshua? For the last year or so, I have tried as hard as possible to be faithful to the Bible, to preach God's word without bias, pure objectivity being impossible, as opposed to being faithful to my own particular political and social views and what I think the world should look like, you know, if everything was perfect. Even without 8 hours of study and preparation, I have tried really hard, maybe too hard, to preach a word that is faithful to Scripture without making anyone feel personally attacked, though some of you may have experienced those sermons differently. This week has been particularly difficult and challenging because of the election. This nation, our nation, is divided. And that division has led to a disrespect and ugliness that has become hatred, that has become violence. And it begs the question whether or not we as Christians, as beloved children of God and followers of Jesus, have placed our ultimate trust more in the political parties and their candidates than we have in God, the source of all life and the source of all love. Moses, in his final address to the Israelites, tells them that he has set before them life and death, blessing and curse, and exhorts them to choose life that they and their offspring might live. Now, Joshua, Moses' successor, finds himself near the end of his life and gathers the people in Shechem to reiterate the choice for life or death that Israel must make yet again. The first verses of our reading remember the gift of the land promised to our ancestors back in the book of Genesis. That land, as Moses had insisted, was a venue filled with seduction and danger for Israel, because it is a land of extravagant abundance. It may seduce Israel into amnesia about its true character and mandate as the people of God. Israel may be tempted to embrace the alternative gods that occupy the good land. The text revolves around the shrewd, ironic awareness that the good land can be a seductive land in which crucial choices must be made. Joshua attests to his community that he and his household have chosen covenantal life with the God who has given both the land and the commandments of Sinai. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. But he fully recognizes that other choices are available, other gods and other ways of life, and a decision must be made. Israel and the church must decide again and again about identity, about defining passions and loyalties. As Joshua points out to the Israelites, who very quickly say they will serve the Lord as well, God wants more from us than a quick response of verbal agreement. He tells them, "You cannot serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good." What this God requires is a life commitment that will impinge upon every dimension of public life, social, political, and economic. This God, so says Joshua, is uncompromising. With God, it is all or nothing. No casual allowance for accommodation. What is at issue is a jealous God who is committed to neighborly justice and the organization of an economy for the sake of the weak and vulnerable. The either-or decision that Joshua presents has immediate practical social consequences. A decision for God entails socioeconomic justice. A decision for the other gods leads inevitably to socioeconomic exploitation, the accumulation of wealth at the expense of neighbors. What is before us in our society, as it was before Joshua and his companions, is a life or death decision about God and neighbor. The God decision is a recognition that we are not autonomous to do whatever we may want to do. The God of covenant is no therapeutic pushover who benignly accepts selfish anti-neighborliness and the cheapening of the human fabric. The neighbor decision is an awareness that the ones unlike us merit because they are present, inclusion in the abundance, opportunity, and justice for all of the community, so that we are not free to engage in private greed and individual selfishness. I have had it pointed out to me that to make the God decision, to choose to follow Jesus faithfully all the way, is impractical in the 21st century. That were we to live according to God's word in the way of life modeled by Jesus in this confusing and complex world of ours, there would be so many unintended negative consequences that everything would fall apart. Our current political and economic systems would collapse and thrust everything back into the dark ages. And this may be true, but the choice is still before us, and we must make a choice. Make the choice and stay committed to it. There are no caveats with the God decision. Who will we serve? Who will you serve? Friends, whatever happens in our nation's election, we are called not to serve, to place our ultimate trust in one political party over another, one candidate over another, one social philosophy over another. We are called to serve the Lord, to place our ultimate trust in God, God who created the entire universe and each one of us, God who knows the hairs on your head, God who has liberated from whatever chains keep you from living into your full beloved humanity, God who has always been with you in the wilderness, sustaining you with the bread of life and living water, God who has carried you out of the darkness and into the marvelous light, God who shows you mercy and infinite grace despite our constant strain and turning away, God who heals us and makes us whole. This God demands a decision from you, from us. Who will we serve? Will we choose winning over serving God? Will we choose being right over serving God? Will we choose any of the other little gods vying for our commitment and devotion? Little gods who distract us with shiny objects and promises of abundance and healing that are not theirs to offer. Little gods who have caused us to forget, have created a sort of spiritual amnesia, that somehow everything we have has been earned entirely by our own merit and is not at its very source a gift of grace from a loving and generous God. Little gods who try to convince us that it is all about looking out for yourself, getting what is somehow owed you, and not loving our neighbor as God loves us, sharing from our abundance and creating a world where everyone has access to the same human rights, the same justice and opportunities, to be treated with the same dignity and respect, and where everyone knows love and belonging. God's challenging, surprising, life-changing, prophetic word is not liberal or conservative, Democrat or Republican. It is God's word for us. And God's word for us this day is a very serious, significant, vital, and life-transforming, world-transforming question. Who will you serve? Because you gotta serve somebody. And as for me, I choose to serve God. However flawed and imperfectly, I choose to serve God. Who will you serve? And to God alone be all the glory. Amen. And now let us join our hearts and minds together and share them with God in prayer. Holy Mystery, you are the source of our life, the love that sustains us and the very breath that fills our lungs. You are the cause of our rejoicing, even in the face of challenge and confusion. We are grateful for the way you have heard us in the past, the deep faithfulness you show to us on this day of new beginnings, and the way you beckon all of us to follow you into your future. We are deeply grateful for who you are, for the gift of being created good and in your image, and for the way that you knit us together as your body. Author of all grace, yours is the voice we can scarcely hear because you speak to us about grace and mercy, belonging and unconditional love, death as the way to new life. We are impacted by so many other voices that have to do with power and competence, success and failure, diminishment and judgment, voices that tempt us to turn from you and create you in their image, in the image of one who will confirm our images and save us from our worst fears. We do know that you are the voice that gives us life. You are the voice that opens futures to people who are hopeless. We are part of a people who at times feels hopeless, or at least cynical or complacent, because the other voices eat at our hearts. We are immobilized and we become deaf. So we pray for new ears. We pray that your voice may be made more audible to us, that we may be able to sort out the death-dealing from the life-giving voices among us, that we might find ourselves thinking only about all that is true and just and excellent and worthy of praise. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for our faithful ancestors that envisioned a land of freedom and opportunity, a land in which to grow respect for all its citizens. We give you thanks for all who sacrificed in so many ways to create and to sustain such a vision. We give you thanks for the many ways in which that vision has been and continues to be embraced and made manifest as a better tomorrow is shaped for all within these borders and beyond them as well. We thank you for the call to let freedom shine, to let celebration of the dignity of all resound. But we also confess to you the many ways in which we fall short. Forgive us for our lack of creativity in sharing our nation's abundance equitably, for tarnishing our political process with greed, for failing the needy. Help us to develop a love, your love, which demonstrate care and compassion for others. Help us in a world full of loss and sorrow to know real joy. Help us to work for peace in a world which seems to prefer violence. Help us in our hurry-up world to develop patience and to learn that all does not have to be completed in our hurry-up time. Help us to demonstrate kindness to all, and especially to those with whom we find it especially difficult to be kind. Help us to show generosity with our resources and to learn how to be generous in our encounters with other people. We pray for your healing and comfort with all those who are grieving, who are ill or struggling with chronic health conditions, who are suffering from trauma or uncertainty. Bring stability and renewal to families who have been hurt or lost lives to the COVID pandemic, as well as recent natural and violent disasters. Grant all your people, your peace that surpasses all human understanding. We pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Deep peace of the rolling waves to you, deep peace of the silent stars. Deep peace of the blowing air to you, deep peace of the quiet earth. Let peace, fill your soul. Peace of the rolling waves to you, deep peace of the silent stars. Deep peace of the blowing air to you, deep peace of the quiet earth. Let peace, fill your soul. Deep peace of the rolling waves to you, deep peace of the silent stars. Deep peace of the blowing air to you, deep peace of the quiet earth. Let peace, fill your soul.
Hi friends, Deacon Dave Hansen here with a message from your Deacon team. Once again, we would like to help Neighbors Inc. with their Adopt a Family program. This program allows us to buy Christmas presents for children in need. We have three families this year with children ages 7 months to 17 years old. Next. Each family has a wish list of what presents their children would like to see. In total, we have 10 kiddos. Next. Remember how we did it last year? We had a Christmas tree in the commons with stars representing each child's wish. You took a star and bought the gift. Obviously, we can't do that this year with the church building being closed. Next. So we've come up with a plan. You can contact me, Dave Hansen, and I'll give you a gift to buy. I can be reached at email dhanson1333@comcast.net or cell phone 651-278-7956. Or you can send money to the church and a deacon will buy the gifts for you. If you send a check, put Adopt a Family in the memo line, or you can beam it online at fpcssp.org. Next. Imagine how happy the children of our families will be when they have presents to open on Christmas. And we can make that happen. Please help. On behalf of the deacon team, I thank you.
God's wisdom turns the wisdom of the world upside down. God calls us to unexpected and extravagant opportunities to grow in our gifts and in our faith. Holding things close in fear distracts us from the path of discipleship. But trusting in God and in God's future leads us to great generosity and joy. Let us gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. You can send them directly to the church building or through our website. Look for and click on the box marked Donations. Both addresses are on the screen beside me. And now, trusting in your continuing generosity, let us dedicate our offerings. Let us pray. Living God, we offer ourselves and our decision to serve you with our gifts, confident that you have a purpose for them and for us. Expand our limited vision to embrace new possibilities. May our offerings reach beyond the barriers of our former thinking and doing. We pray all this in the Spirit of Christ Jesus. Amen.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness.
sisters and brothers. We are called to serve the Lord, to place our ultimate trust in God, God who created the entire universe and each one of us, God who knows the hairs on your head, God who has liberated you from whatever chains keep you from living into your full beloved humanity, God who has always been with you in the wilderness, sustaining you with the bread of life and living water, God who has carried you out of the darkness and into the marvelous light, God who shows you mercy and infinite grace despite our constant strain and turning away, God who heals us and makes us whole. This God demands a decision from you, from us. Who will we serve? Who will you serve? And now may the blessing of God, the grace and love of our divine Father and Mother, the justice and humility of the Son, our brother Jesus, and the communion and inspiration of the Holy Spirit be with you and abide in you from this day forward and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.